Good evening, everyone. Just checking. I'm Lee Goldman. I'm the dean of the medical school, and it's really my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all here tonight to one of our periodic doc talks. And tonight, the docs are going to talk about brain disorders that really relate to behavior and to what we call psychiatry, although, as I think you'll hear, increasingly the boundaries between what we call neurology and what we call psychiatry are blurring a bit. And as modern psychiatry discovers more and more about how the brain really works, I think we'll continue to see some of this blurring, if you will. It's a very distinguished panel, but I'm not going to introduce the panel. I'm just going to introduce Dr. Jeffrey Lieberman, who's chair of the Department of Psychiatry and has been a spectacular leader of the department. And just to make one other comment, which he's heard me make before, but I will not be able to resist repeating. I'm a cardiologist, and I often say that back when I started in cardiology, we thought that heart disease was something that was sort of out of your control, and psychiatric diseases were your fault. And fast forward or slow forward during my career, and now we think that a lot of heart diseases are kind of our own fault. I'm drinking some red wine, which hopefully will compensate for some of my other faults. We really think that we can prevent most of heart disease, and increasingly we're recognizing that overwhelmingly psychiatric diseases are not our fault, but they really are embedded in many ways in our genes, and as I said before, are a kind of neurologic dysfunction about which hopefully we'll be learning more, especially in this coming year of precision medicine. So with that as my introduction, it's my pleasure to turn, actually you've got microphones, turn the podium over to Jeff Lieberman, who will introduce the panel. Great to have you here tonight.
Thank you very much, Dean Goldman, and really it's a pleasure to be here in such a beautiful setting. I've never been in this building before, but I'd like to come back. This is a series that Columbia University Medical Center and organizes for the purposes of trying to present information about specific medical scientific related topics. And tonight we're talking about the brain, and particularly the part of the brain that deals with the higher mental functions that can be disturbed in what are called mental disorders or psychiatric illnesses. In many ways, it's really kind of, you know, a matter of nomenclature, because the brain is such a vastly more complicated organ than any other in the body that it requires three specialties. It requires neurosurgery, neurology, and psychiatry. And psychiatry, either by luck or whatever, got the conditions and the real estate that are the most highly evolved parts of the human body in the entire animal kingdom. You know, the cerebral cortex, the limbic system, the part that really deals with emotion, perception, thought, and have also proved to be the most challenging to really define and to identify the footprints of. So as a result of that, in the 21st century, all of our disorders virtually in the DSM, the Bible of Psychiatric Disorders, 265 conditions, are defined syndromally by signs, symptoms, and history. There's only diagnostic tests for two. One is narcolepsy, and the other is Alzheimer's, because now there's amyloid, radioligands, and CSF protein measures. The rest are all, you know, how do you feel, when did it start, and they're descriptive phenomenologic. Now, progress in research has, I think, promised appropriately that at some point we will be able to have definitive laboratory tests for mental disorders like we do glucose for diabetes and blood pressure for hypertension and angiograms to determine coronary artery disease. But even before that could happen, the specter of something called personalized or precision medicine has evolved. And this has really promised to transform all of medicine, including psychiatry, and sooner rather than later. So precision medicine is something which, in effect, takes these syndromal diagnoses of depression, anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorder, eating disorder, autism, schizophrenia, and promises or offers the possibility of peeling the onion, of dissecting them into much more precise categories that pertain to that individual and how they got to that point where they look like they've got this disorder or that disorder and therefore warrant this treatment. And as you can imagine, it's a much more precise way of diagnosing and a much more efficient way of determining what treatment they should receive. So we're going to hear tonight about what I think is really one of the most visionary programs in the world and at any American academic institution, which is going on at Columbia as a result of President Bollinger identifying precision medicine as a university-wide initiative. So it's quite a thing to think that a First Amendment lawyer who's really steeped in the humanities has countenanced a medical scientific theme for a university-wide initiative, but that's what's happening. And the first thing that was done in that context was to kind of empower Dean Goldman to go out and recruit somebody to be the kind of hub of this enterprise. And it led to a world-class geneticist, David Goldstein. And when David arrived on campus, his job was to connect to a bunch of faculty who could really apply his expertise to their particular area and establish collaborations. And what you see in front of you are some of the faculty who are involved in the field of psychiatry that have really sprung to the fore and gotten in on the ground floor and are in the process of establishing collaborations. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So let me just introduce them. So David hails from California. He was educated as an undergraduate at UCLA. Then he got a PhD in genetics and biological sciences at Stanford. He then came to Duke, where he was the head of a genome center there before we lured him to New York City. To my immediate right is Jeremy Veenstra-VanderWeele, easy for you to say, who hails from Chicago and went to undergrad at Harvard and then got his medical degree and PhD at the University of Chicago and then was a child psychiatrist at Vanderbilt before we recruited him to New York as one of the leading researchers in the area of pediatric neurodevelopmental disorders and particularly autism. And next to Jeremy is Blair Simpson. Blair is a psychiatrist who was went to undergraduate school at Yale and then medical school at Cornell and also simultaneously got a PhD at Rockefeller, came to Columbia for training, and now is arguably the leading authority in the world on obsessive compulsive, or as I think of them, basal ganglia striatal perseverative disorders.
Just rolls off the tongue.
My wife loves it when I talk dirty like this. And next to Blair is Sander Markx. So Sander hails from the Netherlands and graduated from the University of Amsterdam, came to the United States and Columbia for his training, and has become the lead faculty member in our department to establish a program in precision neuropsychiatry that can, one, be a focus for research, but also begin to implement and provide these services for clinical care. So to begin, let me just ask David to opine on what exactly do we mean by precision medicine? It's a term that's frequently used, but it's important to understand what it actually means.
So let me just start with a tiny bit of history. I started my PhD work in 1990, which was exactly when the Human Genome Project was being designed. And so what that means is throughout the entirety of my professional career, folks like me have been promising folks like you that we are going to transform medicine with genetics and genomics. And during that entire period, almost the entire period, I've actually resisted joining that group of people promising that we're going to transform medicine. So I had a lot of skepticism about the kind of impact we would have and the timing of the impact. And I'm here to say that I can resist no longer. So I am finally joining the rest of the genomicists and saying, we really are right now just on the edge of transforming medicine in all sorts of ways with genomics. There are a number of reasons for that, and I won't go into them in detail because Jeff is empowered to cut me off, and so I definitely won't provide too much detail. But a couple of the primary reasons are, number one, we can very, very quickly and very accurately identify all the changes in people's genomes right now, almost all the changes. And what that means is that when there is a particular change in a genome that contributes strongly to disease, we can find it. And we can do that at a very, very large scale. The other thing that's changed that is truly important is that once we find these causes of disease, we can actually study them. We have incredible tools now for editing genomes, meaning we can take a mutation that causes a disease and we can put it into a mouse genome and ask, what does that do to the behavior of the mouse? Put these things together and we really are, for a number of disease areas, poised to make a transformational difference in care. Now, this is no longer aspirational in some disease areas. So, for example, in epilepsy, what I described is happening right now. You find the mutation that's responsible for an epilepsy, you understand what it does. Understanding what it does tells you what you can do to undo the effect of that precise mutation, and you get a targeted compound to undo the effect of the mutation. Now, this is what I think of as precision medicine. It's not just matching up an individual's genome to a treatment. What it is using genomics and other approaches to understand the cause of disease, having understood the cause of disease, try to target a treatment to that underlying cause. Columbia has actually created an integrated vision to pursue this kind of a program in as many areas as possible. And in fact, that's exactly the reason that I wanted to come. And when Columbia's vision was outlined by President Bollinger and Dean Goldman, I actually decided on the spot that I wanted to come. And to Dean Goldman's credit, I think he knew that, but he acted like he didn't when we negotiated. In any event, the work that that we're talking about here really is an example of why I came to Columbia. And what we now want to do is bring what is already happening in areas like epilepsy to psychiatry. I will say it's going to be a slightly harder challenge because the genetics are going to be a little bit more difficult, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't try.
So Blair, you know, David has the skills to be able to do the most powerful and sophisticated genotyping, with exome sequencing and whole genome sequencing and looking for mutations and so forth. I mean, as somebody who's sort of focused on anxiety disorders and obsessive compulsive disorders, I mean, how is this going to be applied in what you do, and what kind of results would you expect to produce?
So I feel like I lucked out, right? So when I first met David Goldstein with the other faculty, and we went around the room, and he was saying what he was doing, and he happened to mention, oh, and I also have these grants in OCD. I was like, really? You have these grants in OCD? Can we talk? And what David really, I think, is articulating is this promise of precision medicine that's sweeping other areas of medicine. Why leave psychiatry out? Why should psychiatry be left behind? And what David's vision is, which I find so exciting, is really targeting psychiatric disorders that have a high genetic component. So you wouldn't go after depression, actually. In fact, depression is so heterogeneous and there isn't a strong signal. But if you think about the psychiatric diseases that have high heritability, meaning we know that there's not only a genetic cause, but a strong genetic cause, you'd pick autism, autism, schizophrenia, and OCD. So that's the project that, David said, why don't we, so I direct the Anxiety Disorders Clinic. We see hundreds of anxiety and OCD patients every year. And he said, why don't we start with OCD, because it's a very highly, more heritable than the other anxiety disorders. Let's start with people who have onset before age 18, which we already know has more higher heritability. And let's genome sequence every person who walks through your clinic. And you, our expertise is really the clinical phenotyping and the treatment, and his expertise is the genomic analysis. And let's take a project where we do 400, let's say, and see, can we actually look at their genome and relate it to anything that could tell us why they got OCD, that individual got OCD, and or relate it to why that person might have either gotten a fabulous treatment response, what we call super responders, or no treatment response from standard treatments. So that's actually this, you know, so Dean Goldman, thank you so much. I mean, this is, you know, this is really very exciting. And it's also true, David's taught me a lot about this promise. And I have also been one of these psychiatrists on the side that have thought, oh boy, am I glad I didn't go into genetics. Like, what a waste, you know, what a, like, just drowned, you know, I don't know, no man's zone. I now feel differently. I now feel really, really excited the way David does about the possible promise, not only for OCD, but for other disorders in psychiatry.
So applying this to OCD, but, you know, everybody may not know what you mean by OCD. So you have OCD, you have, I mean, it's to who? Is it to people with personalities? We all have OCD tendencies. Is it a hoarding disorder?
No. So what we're talking about is, you know, if you start with the genetic studies, right? So OCD is this very particular disorder where the hallmarks are people have intrusive thoughts, images, or urges that are very upsetting to them, and then they have repetitive behaviors. So the classic version is intrusive fears about contamination and then washing rituals. But that's only one of many different types. You can also have intrusive fears about harming others, and you're checking all the time. You can have this sense of things aren't just right and you're ordering and arranging. And we know from twin studies and from family genetic studies, again, that there's an early onset version of this disorder that has high heritability and is up there with autism and schizophrenia, unlike our other psychiatric disorders. So that's where you start. You don't start with, I mean, I'm not to say that personality disorders might not have a genetic component, but the data, I don't think, are as strong to start there. I mean, I don't know, David, would you? He's my teacher. So.
No, on the contrary, so I agree with everything you've said. And I would have trouble actually giving a good definition of OCD before working with you. So I would
but
not
what's great,
you,
no, no, but what's great is that David, before completely, so that's the other big change in the field that I actually think excites me too, if I can say it, which is, you know, we've been going after huge genetic studies to try to find common variants. And you know better than I, right? There's now this big study in schizophrenia of hundreds of common variants in schizophrenia. Well, what does that do for you if you're a clinician? You know, that there can be so many common variants, that suggests that each of those only has a little impact. And David's actually been interested in not the common variants for disease, but the rare variants. Because if you find rare variants that lead to high penetrance to disease, even if it's only in a handful of people, you actually might have something more specific to target. So just by luck, David had been doing OCD studies of rare variants. So the other secret behind this collaboration, it's not just the approach, but David's in on the ground floor of what's being found in these rare variant studies. And so that's the other excitement, which is, can we collect in my clinical sample of patients and really clinically phenotype them in a way those big studies can't? They just know OCD, yes, no. I'm going to know everything about my patients, including their treatment history. And in our protocol, we're not only going to genome sequence them, but we have the ability to call people back. So that's another huge difference. In those big studies, you don't call anybody back. It's all de-identified. I'm going to get to say to people, will you be in my study? And if we find something that we think might be related to your OCD, would you like me to call you back and let you know, let your clinician know? Because then that provides us the ability to actually take that subset, because we don't think it's going to be in everyone, but take that subset and really now do more studies, not only in them, but also in the mice.
So I think an important thing that we've learned in scientific research is to overpromise and underpromise and overdeliver. That was not a Freudian slip. I'm not a Freudian psychiatrist. And so what the approach that Blair's alluding to is that the populations that we think have the most sort of promise is severe individuals with a given disorder, you know, that are the outliers, so to speak, the most severe, that are likely to have these mutations that will be actionable with, you know, novel therapeutic strategies that you wouldn't have thought of using if they didn't have that mutation. So, Sander, you've been kind of designated as to sort of establish the precision neuropsychiatry program in psychiatry and apply it to mental disorders. How are you going to go about doing this and working with David?
Well, I should highlight that our focal interest areas are mostly regarding patients who suffer from autism or schizophrenia, so it's different from Blair. It's also a little different from what Jeffrey does. So we all have complementary approaches, I think, in what we want to do. But for me personally, when David arrived, it was a game changer. We had already sort of set in motion this plan to pursue precision medicine in psychiatry. But the thing you learn pretty quickly is that it's a humbling experience, is that you cannot do this on your own. It's very much a team effort. And realizing that Columbia, all the way from Lee Bollinger to Dr. Goldman and to Dr. Goldstein, that there was such a collective effort to push this forward really made it the perfect time to set this up in psychiatry as well. How we will go about it, I think we're going to pursue two major things right off the bat. One, we have found several variants that cause disorders like autism, for example, and schizophrenia. And we have an idea in the precision medicine context of what the disease mechanism is that is associated with those particular variants. And so since the data is so overwhelmingly strong and very much in the vein, the way that Dr. Goldstein described, we've already done the work where we tested in mice, what are the consequences of that particular mutation on a mouse model? And what you see in these animals is that they harbor a lot of the same features that human beings with autism in this case have. We were able to follow a precision medicine approach, and we're able to identify what we think is the or one of the core disease mechanisms associated with that mutation. And just like David is describing, we were able to screen for drugs that target that particular molecular defect. And when we give the mice who are behaviorally very impaired, we give them that drug in that model, those mice are cured of whatever autism in the mouse is. Now, the obvious caveat here is that we don't know if this is translatable to humans, but there's only one way to find that out. And inspired by the collective efforts and feeling that this is the time to really try, we're trying to put ourselves out there and essentially start the first clinical trial in psychiatry where we will take that approach and try to take a drug that targets disease mechanisms specific to that mutation and use a very novel drug that's just about to come on the market for a completely different indication. We're going to ask the FDA if we can use that drug for this purpose, and we're going to do one of the first trials like that. At the same time, in parallel with David, we feel that we need to reach out to populations that are particularly at risk for carrying these kinds of variants, these rare variants that Dr. Simpson also mentioned, that are likely to cause disease. So we're setting out to screen a large number of patients, 3,000, who are affected with severe forms of mental illness, in particular psychosis, schizophrenia, and related conditions. And in collaboration with David, we're going to screen them for whatever causative mutations they might have. And if the clinical trial efforts pan out, as we hope they will, we will then extrapolate and learn from that trial and start to implement that in other segments of the patient population. The ultimate goal down the road, you know, that we strive for is that ultimately we hope to introduce a way to assess an individual patient who comes to your office where you take blood and you assess completely what is their genomic architecture like, what mutations do they carry, what is their immune system like, is it overactive, is it attacking brain cells, all these things will be mapped. And based on that, we'll have a better sense of what's going on. We can then test, just like David mentioned, what is the consequence of each of these risk variants in model systems like a mouse model or stem cell work. And then by identifying what the cause is, just like we did with this other particular mutation, we will screen drugs, select the ones that work, and essentially start a trial for any given individual patient. So that's the ultimate goal that we're all striving for. And it sounds a bit like science fiction in psychiatry, but in oncology and other parts of medicine, this is exactly what's happening. And in epilepsy, pioneered by David, this is happening today. So just like David said, we're not absolutely, there's no guarantee this will work, but we have a lot of faith that it might, and we think we have to try.
So let me just mention the fact that there are on your seats or in your programs question cards. If you'd rather write a question rather than ask a question, there will be opportunity to ask questions orally if you want. But just note that that's another way to submit questions. Let me just, before getting Jeremy, ask Dave. So Sanders outlined an approach with specific disorders that have a high heritability and in extreme forms of the illness. Is this like searching for a needle in the haystack, or is this something that has a little better odds of identifying something? I mean, it serves the purpose of research, but in terms of actionable clinical findings.
So as I was listening, I was thinking, where do I sign up? And of course, I realized I'm already involved. I really, really, truly am persuaded that we can make this work. What I can't do is, I mean, I don't know for sure. This is new. But I really do feel that there is very good reason to believe that we will be able to find for a proportion of the individuals that are affected with these conditions, we will be able to find the kind of genetic contributions that we can actually work with in the laboratory. And what I can't say is what that proportion is going to be. I don't think it's going to be a majority. So that's my own, I have no way of proving any of this, but my own personal orientation is it won't be a majority. In fact, in any of the conditions that we're talking about, not in schizophrenia, not in OCD, not in autism. So it's not going to be the case that 3 or 4 years from now we'll be together again here and we'll be able to tell you that over the last few years we've been able to genetically explain the majority of individuals with autism and OCD and schizophrenia. That won't happen in my view. What I think will happen is that a small proportion of individuals with each of those conditions, we will actually find very strong genetic contributions. And just as Sander was describing, we will actually find targeted treatments for those, and they will help in those individuals. Now, what I find exciting, some of those treatments that help in those genetically defined individuals, they might help in other people too that don't have those genetic causes. So I really am a believer.
I think the important thing to mention is that the treatments that the genetic findings lead to are things you never would have thought of using for those particular conditions.
Exactly.
So if not for that, you would not have used the treatment that hopefully would be effective. But so, Jeremy, the genetic complexity that has been described, does that pertain to pediatric disorders and particularly to the neurodevelopmental disorders, or is it simpler?
Is it simpler? So we look for extremes typically in order to at least get the first sense of the genes that may contribute to a disorder. And that means actually you're more likely to see these things emerge in childhood, early childhood. So childhood onset schizophrenia certainly has a bigger genetic signal. Pediatric OCD has a bigger genetic signal. The developmental disorders have a bigger genetic signal still. And that doesn't mean it's entirely genetic. And I think that this is one of the things that we sometimes hear from folks, well, you're only talking about genes. And I know when I first got started as a 20-year-old in a molecular genetics lab, I was like, well, why genes? Part of it is, even though genetics is really hard, it's much easier than figuring out environmental contributions that may be lurking under the surface. And that's, that's a hard message, but it also gives us the opportunity sometimes to understand a genetically defined population where still not every single person gets, and Allison and I were just talking about this, but not every single person ends up getting whatever your definition of the disease is. So you might understand what leads some people not to be affected. In autism in particular, we're in sort of a different spot than most disorders that are defined as psychiatric disorders, which is to say, when a child comes in and gets a diagnosis of autism, all of the recommendations say that that child is then supposed to get genetic testing. They're supposed to get genetic testing for Fragile X syndrome. They're supposed to get what's called a chromosomal microarray. And about 10% of the time, they come back with a genetic finding that says this is maybe not the sole cause, but the biggest reason that this child is affected with autism spectrum disorder, which is a big deal. Now, how much of the time does that shape treatment? Right now, hardly ever. There are a few examples that are incredibly exciting, but what it takes is to then have these individual findings, take them into cell models, take them into mouse models. This is what the molecular side of me does. We look for drugs that work in mouse models that are modeling something that is, if not causal, the largest risk factor for autism in an individual child. A couple promising drugs there. It's a long path to bring it to humans. And that's where, again, autism and developmental disorders are maybe a little bit ahead. So for the last 5 years or so, maybe a little longer now, I've been involved in helping in a group of people try to find treatments in Fragile X syndrome, where for the last 20 plus years, we've had a genetic finding that clearly contributes to risk of autism. For the last 10 years, there's been a reasonable theory for how that might happen. A little less time, there's been a reason to think that particular drugs might be helpful. But then carrying that forward into the clinic is a challenge. So that's where we're behind schizophrenia and behind OCD. In these disorders, there are medication treatments that work. You know how to measure that. You can tell when something is leading to a benefit in psychosis or in compulsions. We've never had a medicine that particularly helps in autism. And so that's the other side of precision medicine, that in developing rationally based targeted therapeutics, we have the ability finally to understand what it looks like when something improves, not based on a treatment that may be the best we've got, but sort of functions like a Band-Aid, but based on something that really addresses the core biology. And that's, you know, that's the incredible promise. But I can also say, you know, I've been working in this area for 20 years. I know you're looking at me and thinking, in any case, so I've been working in this area
don't
for 20.
Don't flatter yourself.
My hair is starting to fade. But this is, you know, this is something we've been working on for a long time. And like David says, this isn't something that we're going to have immediately as a treatment for every child that walks in. Boy, I wish it was. This is something that we're going to have to continue to invest in. But we are on the cusp of seeing things where you can make a diagnosis on a test that makes sense to send. And you can say, well, your particular child we think will do better with this particular treatment, which is really incredible from where we were even 5 years ago.
Is there an epidemic of autism?
There's a steep increase in autism diagnosis. I wouldn't call it an epidemic. I think that there are real reasons that autism, the pattern of autism, are increasing. Some of them are actually good news. So many more babies are saved in neonatal intensive care units. Those babies go on to have an increased risk of developmental problems. We're not going to change what we do to rescue those babies, but trying to figure out ways to intervene earlier to help them, we absolutely want to do. Older parents are at significantly higher risk of having a child with an autism spectrum disorder or any developmental disorder. That's something that certainly is increasing in society. But we also have removed a lot of the stigma. So kids who used to get labeled with something else or bullied now get a diagnosis and get help, which makes a huge difference. And we know much better how to look for autism. We used to really only see it when it was incredibly obvious. And now we look for folks who may just seem like they're shy, but when you probe, they're not shy. They're struggling to figure out what this person in front of them is about. And that's something that we're much better able to do. So it's really unclear if there are other things going on beyond that. I'd say it's a question we don't have a perfect answer to. This is the difficulty with having scientists up here, right? We admit the things that we don't know. And there is this sort of momentum around the idea that there is an epidemic.
Well, I mean, just to try and frame your answer, it sounds like you're saying that in large part it's just better identification and broadening of the spectrum,
yep.
But it's also there may be some secular effects like aging of parents and being able to save children that have been had traumatic deliveries or maybe assisted reproductive strategies.
We know less about that. But yeah, those are the factors that we can say are real and are really there. Whether there's some other increase, it's really hard to say. It's probably not the majority of the increase.
So, you know, when you talk about genetics, you talk about heritability. And you through research, we've learned that there's like inherited mutations that can occur, and there's de novo or spontaneous mutations. So from a genetic counseling standpoint, if people ask about, what are my chances of having a child, or, if my child does have some illness and a gene, is it from me, or how did it happen? I mean, how do we think about it now if we've been able to formulate an approach, maybe beginning with you, David.
Well, in some cases, it's very informative from a counseling perspective. So in the neurodevelopmental diseases, we very often do find that brand new mutations are responsible. They, if not the only contributor, they make a major contribution. And if an individual has a brand new mutation, then you can say that the risk to siblings for the individual is almost the same as the population risk. It actually turns out to be not exactly the same because the mutation may actually be present at very, very low levels in one of the parents, but it is almost the same.
And you want to just explain if it's a spontaneous mutation, why it occurs or how it occurs?
Yeah, so the way that the, there are different kinds of brand new mutations, but point mutations actually occur primarily, the ones that are inherited in the gametic cells that the man passes on to his child. And so the mutations that occur in those sex cells are actually what appear as de novo mutations. Now, if they appear a little bit earlier than the last divisions in those sex cells, then they actually can be passed on to more than one offspring. For those point mutations, the primary determinant of how many you have is actually your father's age. So if you have a young father, if you look at the genome as a whole, it's about 3 billion places in the genome. If you look at the genome as a whole, if you have a young father, there'll be 50 or 60 places out of those 3 billion where you have a brand new mutation. And as long as those 50 or 60 places are not all that important, that's okay. If you have an older father, you might have 200 or 300 places in the genome where you've got a brand new mutation. That, of course, increases the chance that one of them falls in a place that's really important. And that's, of course, how these brand new mutations can give rise to neurodevelopmental diseases.
Blair, Sander, Jeremy, comment on the whole, what do you tell parents, what do you tell people about how to understand this phenomenon and what could be done, if anything, about it?
You know, I, when I think about OCD, the data suggests that if you have OCD, then the rate of OCD in your first degree relative, let's say your parents, is 10%, whereas the rate in the population is 2%. So you can see that there's an elevated rate, but it's not like it's 1-to-1. And I think that's where the issue of it's not just common variants that come down through your parents, there can be de novo variants, and then obviously then there can be risk that then you need the environment, an environmental trajectory to actually bring out the illness. So I think in OCD, we're at a place where it's very heterogeneous, and we're not sure about that. We're not sure, and I guess I would add one other thing, which I'm sort of curious about, which is, you know, David, the way I understand it is we're not only looking at what puts the individual at risk for OCD, but it's also true that if we actually found genetic variation that actually could influence treatment response, even if it doesn't have anything to do with why the person got OCD, heck, as a clinician, I'm interested in that too. So as an example for that, and that's not just medication, it's not just novel medications. So I'll give you an example from anxiety disorders where there's a gene variant that's been associated with the ability to extinguish fear in laboratory experiments in mice and in healthy people. And now there's our main psychotherapy for anxiety disorders is cognitive behavioral therapy, where you do exposures with people, which people think is like extinction learning in those laboratory paradigms. And so people have looked at that gene variant to ask, can that predict who does better and who does worse in CBT treatments? Are you guys following me? So there's an example, right? There's an example of a gene variant that might have nothing to do with why you ended up with OCD, but it might have something to do with, if you go into CBT therapy, why you do really well or why you don't. So that's another, I see it as I'm interested as a clinician, not only in risk to why they got the disease and the mechanism, I think that's very important, but I also think what could come out of this is gene variants that alter treatment response. And we have examples of that in other areas of medicine.
Yeah. I'll say two things about that. One is my So I'm very conscious of precision medicine because my mom lived probably an extra 8 years with breast cancer due to Herceptin, which was one of the first really precision-targeted treatments in medicine. And that's, you know, that's an incredible thing to have, and I'd like to see us have something like that. And you're right, it doesn't have to be that this is the sole determinant of somebody's illness. It may guide you to a pathway that's useful for treatment. I have conversations with families fairly frequently about, do they have another child? What's the risk to the next child? How do you think about that? This means very different things depending on your perspective, glass half full, glass half empty, but we now actually have data that shapes that to some extent. So we now know if you have an older sibling with autism spectrum disorder, your likelihood of having it, if you're an infant, is somewhere between 17 and 20%. But if you're able to identify using one of those tests that we now send that the older sibling has an inherited copy number variant, so an inherited variant that contributes to their illness, you can then actually test for that prenatally. You can give a much clearer sense of risk to the next child. If, on the other hand, you run more advanced testing, so you actually do genome sequencing or at least exome sequencing, identify one of these de novo variants, you can be reassured that actually your risk is much lower if the older sibling has one of these de novo variants. Maybe lower, probably lower than that 17% that's present in the general population, but those studies are still pending. So this is one of the things that families struggle with, and you have to make that decision. And we actually have the beginnings of information. Now, family planning isn't what we want. What we want is actually something that leads to early intervention and treatment for that next child. But we're closing in on having things that actually can deliver change.
Yeah, well, on one side of my family, I had diabetes, and the other side I had coronary artery disease, but nobody aborted me or, you know, decided to do any kind of intervention. So the question is will any other kind of, will the double standard and the stigma of mental illness somehow carry over into this, which is something to be careful about? Sandra, did you want to add anything to the discussion?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with the panel. I think that my personal stance is that I think we still have to be very cautious with how we interpret the genetic data. I think we were just having a discussion before the meeting with somebody from the audience who mentioned that there's a research program starting looking at one variant where people have family members who have a variant and who are ill and then other families don't. And I think it reminded me of, you know, we're making all these huge steps in trying to understand what are risk variants, but they are just that, risk variants. They increase the risk of the emergence of a mental illness at some point in your life. And I think for the reasons that were stated, I think we want to be very careful with making assumptions. Now, that being said, I think because we all have mutations, many of which don't do anything like David just described. But also, like Jeremy pointed out, for some particular variants, we know a lot more. And then when we know more, we have to advocate and we have to inform families and patients about what we've learned so that they can help factor that in. And you know, the counseling is a vital part of that. I do think that it's going to take a lot of work in the coming years, the work that we are all talking about here, for us to really understand on a statistical level, where do you fall when you have such and such variant, or this combination with that, with this environmental stressor. I mean, it's enormously complex. But I think eventually we'll get really close.
So we're going to open it up to questions, either written or spoken. But before that, I just want to ask David just to clarify for the audience understanding. So the difference between exome sequencing and whole genome sequencing.
So exome sequencing is when we concentrate on that part of the genome that actually makes protein. It's less than 2% of the genome that actually encodes the proteins, which we normally think of as genes. And the reason we have a sequencing technique that concentrates on that part of the genome is that's actually where most of the mutations that are found that we know about that cause disease. Now, there might be a lot of mutations that we don't already know about that cause disease that aren't there, but for the ones that we already know about, they're mostly there. And so a lot of people actually use this particular approach because it zeroes attention in on sort of where the action is for human disease genetics. It's much, much less expensive right now than whole genome sequencing and easier to do. Now, the downside is that there most certainly are variants that are outside of the protein encoding part of the genome that are important, and we are missing them often if we do only whole exome sequencing. And so there's a lot of interest in developing new tools to be able to make effective use of whole genome sequence data.
And these, the other parts of the genome are involved in regulatory and stopping and starting and enhancing and modulatory functions for the part of the genome that actually codes for the proteins that are actually produced and then go into the building blocks of cells in the body. Okay, well, I'd like to invite questions from the audience. Sir?
This is actually a pertinent question. May not seem like really. I've been on the faculty for about 32 years. Down, a little further down. My area is, I'm in social sciences. So the obvious question is, you are doing heroic things. What is the dark part of life? There are ethical issues involved. Instead of manipulating for good, it can also be manipulated for evil.
Well, I guess I have a reputation for being relatively honest in these situations, and so I will be honest. Some of this is scary, and I'll tell you what scares me, frankly. So we most certainly now very clearly can see the technological ability to design genomes of our children, and we can decide that we want to adjust this trait or that trait by editing the genome. It's not just saying we don't want to pass on a major risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. We can do that right now. I personally don't have a problem with that. This is my own personal orientation. But we clearly see the path that could be taken for making adjustments that affect things like height, that affect things like skin color, eye color, and so on. This is going to be technically possible, and I think it's scary. And I think that we're not thinking enough about, as a society, what we ought to be doing about this. We're not getting ready for that. So that's not the topic here, so I'll stop there, but that's my answer.
Was this the reason that Jennifer Doudna called for a moratorium?
Absolutely right. So Jeff is referring to an investigator who is really one of the primary people responsible for recent developments in genome editing, which I was in fact referring to, where I said that we can actually take a mutation we find in a patient that causes disease, and we can very quickly and expensively put it into a mouse genome and see what it does to the mouse. This new editing approach, which is truly astounding in terms of how well it works, how quick it is, how inexpensive it is, was developed in large part by this scientist who recently brought together a number of scientists and had them agree as a group that they wouldn't edit human sex cells with these techniques or embryos. And that's, I think, because they have a lot of concern about what might happen. Now, unfortunately, not everybody that knows how to do this signed up. And in fact, there was editing going on right at the same time they were writing that letter in China. But again, this is, in fact, not, I think, our primary topic.
Dana?
Dr. Goldstein, could you apply this to learning disabilities?
Yes, yeah, so learning disabilities are in fact strongly genetic, and there has been an awful lot of genetics done recently with a lot of findings. And I think it's fair to say that it's not the only place that you can apply this paradigm, but where it works most easily and there is the most reason for near-term optimism is when there are relatively strong genetic contributions. And again, doesn't mean that it's the case in everyone, but in some individuals with learning disabilities, that certainly is the case. And so I think it is reasonable to think that this approach will work there to a degree.
We have a question back here.
Sorry, I'm embarrassed to admit that I might be the only person who gets scientific information from New York Post, but a few days ago, I actually read an article at New York Post, so my question is actually two-part. One is, the article said the cats carry a virus that causes schizophrenia. And that in 18th century, when the English introduced a cats as a pet, and there was an increased incident of schizophrenia. So that I just really wanted to ask whether there's any credibility in that article. And two, if average person like me who has no scientific or medical training is getting a silly or important information like this through New York Post, I mean, where should you come in terms of educating a public in terms of real scientific or relevant medical information that we should be really paying attention to? So I would love to hear that the efforts you're making in terms of educating the public to really get to know more about what you're doing and how they might wish to support your efforts. So there's really two parts question here.
Let me answer the second part and then ask Andrew to comment on the first. So in terms of educating the public, you know, God help us, the misinformation about mental illness and psychiatric treatment is just extraordinarily great, and more so than any other disease area or area of medicine. And try as we might, we're not just pointy-headed scientists hiding in the ivory tower who don't want to sort of talk to people and make people understand. We do. The media doesn't care. They don't care. I mean, unless it's sensationalized in some way. And we've had communications with the New York Times and with the cable news and with the network news programs and all kinds of things. And if anybody has a solution, I'd love to hear about it. My good friend and colleague, Graham Arador, has been beseeching us to spend millions of dollars with the Edelman Company or Burston Marston or somebody to get the word out. And all we're doing is waiting to make the first payment. but it's just like nobody wants to hear, or at least the voices that have platforms don't want to hear. You know, you have Dr. Phil, and you have Dr. Drew, and you've got these kind of psychobabble things, but nothing that's terribly credible. And you know, we'd like to be able to communicate, but it's been tough. Sander, so toxoplasmosis, virus, infectious pathogens.
Thanks,
in 30
Jeff.
Seconds.
So yeah,
that's what you get for reading the New York Post.
Well, I will definitely answer it, but I will get back to the New York Post for a different reason. So, what I know of the toxoplasmosis story: toxoplasmosis is a bug that cats carry, and is transmitted. I'm not going to get into how and what because it's not very appetite stimulating, and it's also controversial. The bug can be transmitted to humans who have an impaired function of their, when their immune system doesn't work properly, and these bugs are not eliminated, they can get an infection, and they can get all sorts of terrible effects of that infection. It's usually only in people who have who are severely immunocompromised. So there are people who believe that people who have not a compromised immune system, who get this infection, still develop an infection, and that may play a role in abnormal brain function, which could, in theory, give rise to schizophrenia.
So, but this is a great example of why this happens. So it's very easy to give the wrong story in few words, right? But giving the right story takes more words and more complexity and acknowledges the uncertainty. So
sure.
If Dr. Markx had just said, oh yeah, toxoplasmosis causes schizophrenia, next question, you'd all leave with that very clearly. And this is what happens when we try to reach out through the media.
Right.
And you're giving the right answer. But it's really hard,
right?
Because there is uncertainty, and this is what the scientific approach is about.
Right.
Young Hayes wants to follow up there.
We need to have time for everybody, so let's move on. Because frankly, this question isn't worth spending that much time on.
There's one thing.
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead, Sander.
There was one thing to quickly add to that, though, which I think is critical. So, in my opinion, what I think is one of the most striking examples of precision medicine in psychiatry today, and that's why I mentioned the New York Post, was highlighted by a journalist for the New York Post. And it involves the immune system, not because of toxoplasmosis, but because that person's immune system started attacking her brain cells. So you may have heard of this book called Brain on Fire, written about Susanna Callan, who developed what is called the anti-NMDA receptor encephalitis. Now, a lot of you know about this now because that's one rare example where word got out. She got out there and she brought people along who told this story over and over again until people realized that this was a real thing. She developed an autoimmune condition as an adult without genetic predisposition, as far as we know, although that may not necessarily hold up, But she essentially became psychotic, just like a patient with schizophrenia does. And she was hospitalized in a psychiatric hospital and was treated with conventional medication, antipsychotics, for psychosis, none of which worked. Now, this is a very simple example where if we are psychiatrists and we see somebody with psychosis, we give antipsychotics because that's supposedly what they're supposed to target. In a person with that autoimmune condition, they will not work at all. Knowledge of what she does have, which is an autoimmune condition, which can be triggered by either having a form of cancer that's rare or having a viral infection which triggers the immune system's response, that immune system that attacks the brain cells, when you are aware of that, we are now able to say, well, what is it attacking? What part of the brain? What cell? What part of the synapse, the part that connects the cells where they communicate? What is being attacked? And there are drugs available right now, FDA-approved immunosuppressants that you can give. And as she can attest to, when you recognize this and you treat it with an immunosuppressant, you can essentially cure this disease in most cases, not all, but many. And curing means like going back to the life as you knew it, even though you were in the hospital, psychotic and struggling profoundly. So I've seen many patients, at least 7, 8, in a short period of time who had this, and it was transformative and humbling to see that because it's not genetics, but it's an example. If you get to the cause and you target the specific cause of a mental illness, you see dramatic reversals. So whether this will hold up for genetic risk factors remains to be seen, but that gives room for hope.
So I think the way to kind of succinctly answer your question is that infectious agents, whether they're viruses or bacteria or prions, there's not evidence to suggest they cause schizophrenia or mental illness per se, except for maybe something like Kuru. But incidental infections can trigger an immune response, which somehow identifies proteins as antigens, and then by acting on those induces the syndrome, and that's what this limbic encephalitis is. Sarah?
Yes, I just wanted to say, as a board member of the hospital, extremely proud of you as our medical school, and I know you're number one. My question really is, there are roles for counseling and therapy, because all of this addresses just a lower probability of identification of where the genome or the gene will have an impact, whether it's Alzheimer's, I believe that's around 35%. So where does the right kind of socialization, what role does the environment of these people, psychiatric diseases play, and what role does the right drug, I'll accept that we'll pinpoint that therapy, how will you bring that to the fore?
So it's very easy in anxiety disorders, right? Because there are two first line treatments for all of our anxiety disorders. One is psychotherapy, and the other one is a class of medications. And almost to a fault, the psychotherapies are superior to our medications. So I see this as, gee, could the genetic risk factor, if I really understood it in individuals, provide me a guide for where I do early intervention? And in anxiety disorders and OCD, the early intervention I'm gonna do are these exposure-based treatments. So I'm really lucky because I've got psychosocial interventions, which I have in already that I know are evidence-based. And now the question is who to deliver them to and who are the people, not everybody responds to them, so how do we develop even better ones for those people? So I don't see the precision medicine thing at all about moving us away from psychosocial approaches. Again, I think what it's about is tailoring treatments to individuals so we get better outcomes.
I'd just like to add to that, and this is actually one of the big reasons why I like doing genetics here. What you don't want to do as a geneticist is just discover genes and then have nothing happen. Here, in the case of the work that we're doing together, Blair has a very long-term relationship with her patients, and she understands what the options are. And what that means is that some of the genetic findings really could inform what she decides to do, and that won't only be drug choice. That is the full range of possible treatments. And that's what's really exciting about integrating the genetics into this rich clinical context.
Nobody should mistake, I mean, I know that modern medicine is criticized for kind of the dehumanization, you know, the idea of the doctor spending time with the patient, and the relationship has been, you know, de-emphasized in the favor of laboratory testing and procedures and so forth. you know, like the classic story is the doctor that walks in the room and the patient's lying there in the bed and he picks up the chart, he reads the chart and he looks at the x-rays and the AKG and then he walks out without talking to the patient. Psychiatry is the last to sort of, you know, succumb to that kind of thing. And in terms of what we know from studies, medication alone is not sufficient and in some ways, you know, less effective. It really comes down to what might be called disease management, which is the use of sort of multiple therapeutic approaches, many of which are psychosocial or psychological. And there's no underestimating the importance of those effects, even when the medication is not effective.
The other thing I guess I'd make, but it goes back to a point Jeremy made, which is if you actually understand some of the genetic risk, you actually now have a platform to start to look at these other really interesting questions like development and the environment, the developmental trajectory, and what happens in the environment, which can either protect you or bring out the illness. So I'm really interested, right, where we have these kids who, it seems like some of them go off and get OCD, some of them go off and get anorexia, some of them go, you know, like there's a, some of the, you know, body dysmorphic disorder, and some of them get nothing at all. They grow out of it. Yeah. And so the question is, what's that? And how do you start with a platform that you could really study those questions too?
And even in a neurodevelopmental disorder where we think that there is something really fundamental going on, where you can identify a genetic change, it's not going to be flipping a switch. It's going to be ideally putting the brain in a position to better learn and then teach. I mean, these are the things we actually know about at this point, how to do the behavioral interventions. We don't want to leave them behind, but we want them to be more beneficial.
Yes, we've got several questions. This lady and Joe, and then we have question back here, and then Allison. Is that you raising your hand? And then the gentleman next to you. I'll see if I can remember that. I'm sorry, go ahead.
This may be silly, but if the older parents seem to be connected to higher levels of whatever conditions, should people be advised to freeze their eggs, freeze sperm, and because maybe that trend will continue having children later in life? Is this a way to protect yourself?
Who wants to touch that one?
My own view is that we don't.
What do you consider older?
That one I can answer because I'm 51 and that's older, I can tell you that. But I think we don't know enough to make recommendations about what people ought to do in terms of reproduction currently. What we do know, and we know this with real quantitative detail, the number of these mutations increases. Now it still remains, even for an individual with older parents, it still remains unlikely that one of these mutations will do something very bad. But we don't know how to compare that to what might be the impact of freezing eggs or freezing sperm. We don't know how to make those comparisons. So right now, I would say we should be upfront that we know that there is this effect. But I don't think we can turn that into a recommendation. I certainly wouldn't do that.
Joe?
Just speaking from personal experience, I'm wondering if there's any genomic basis for looking into drug and alcohol addiction, which affects my family, everybody. Not everybody.
I think the answer is absolutely, but...
Same answer. I mean, there's no question at all that there is a genetic contribution. The nature of the genetic contribution, except in relatively so trivial cases like how you metabolize alcohol, except for those cases, the nature of the genetic contribution remains unknown, and I view it as one of the more complicated genetic traits. So I think that there are probably a lot of different modest genetic contributors, meaning that it's difficult for us to reach in and find one major contributor and try to do something with that information. But that doesn't mean it's not genetic, and it doesn't mean it wouldn't be informative to learn something about the genetics. And there have been a number of efforts. But I think there is consensus that it's partially genetic, and probably consensus that it's relatively complicated genetics.
What do you believe? What do you think about the findings with alcoholism in terms of the risk genes? Are those verified or still?
I don't think that there's, some folks here may know it better, more recently than I do. I actually don't think that there's anything that is universally accepted as individual specific risk factors that aren't of the metabolic sort that I described, at least not that I'm aware of.
Yeah.
Folks agree?
Yeah. And, you know, this is also one of the challenges of something that's relatively common. And so if it's common, it can be actually more difficult to find the genetic contributions.
That's absolutely right.
And that doesn't mean they aren't there. There is some work looking at rare isolated populations where you see something that runs very, very commonly in families and some signals there, but they're in individual families and aren't really spreading to the general population in terms of our understanding yet.
One of the areas is the Native American population.
Right.
Yeah.
Very, very likely there are studies, but I'm not aware of them, but they're very likely they are.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good example of the paradigm of gene-environment interactions. There's likely a genetic susceptibility, right, but the environmental factors of what's happened with that culture have probably contributed to. But yes, ma'am. The microphone, you want to?
That was so exciting to put it in layman's terms, because I've heard so many scientists you hear and you don't understand what they're saying. At the same token, I have a personal question. I have a family member who was just diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and it's Alzheimer's, it's amyloid plaques outside the cell and amyloid plaques in the cell, amyloid angiopathy or something like this, and he doesn't qualify for any trial programs. Is there anything that we could be doing, and I'm sure it's a hard question to answer, is there anything we should be doing, getting a second opinion, or we just leave it be? I guess that's my question.
Well, you know, we don't have disease-modifying treatments for Alzheimer's disease now. You know, we do have these methods for identifying, you know, the disease in terms of amyloid radioligands, and we do have sort of therapeutic strategies. Unfortunately, none of those really sort of panned out definitively. You know, ranging from an antibody, passive and active antibody approach to neuroprotective agents and so forth. I think the best thing you can do is really to, you know, go to the Alzheimer's disease associations, see where clinical trials are being conducted, and you know, query the sites as to whether it might be useful. I mean, the most sophisticated work, I think, is going on with the passive antibody studies that are being conducted, but most of those have failed in people with kind of moderate or advanced forms, and they've now shifted to people with, you know, minimal cognitive impairment or very early forms, thinking that by the time, you know, you have clinical symptomatology and amyloid deposition, that it's already sort of too late. The other thing is now there's been the shift in terms of tau, and this is another potentially toxic protein. And to see there are trials that are focusing on that, because this is sort of another pathogenic mechanism by which the disease could be induced. But, I mean, there's, go on the Alzheimer's websites, look on NIH in terms of what trials are going on, and simply call, but it's pretty much guesswork.
Well, you're also raising a frustrating thing, right? When industry has new drugs, they have a tendency to just want to focus on one specific question because they don't want any problem with their drug in it for something that they're not focused on. And so we as scientists who often see patients, we'd love to try some of these drugs in other areas because we think they might be helpful, but we often don't get access to them. So in a sense, you're mirroring, you have a family member who you'd like to get, maybe try one of, be in one of these trials, even if it's not perfect, maybe. But a lot of times the industry partnership, they have a different perspective on it, and there becomes sort of this problem of, you know, again, drugs on the shelf. We have the sense of there are drugs on the shelf that maybe we could try and repurpose, but we don't always get access to them as scientists.
Yeah, if there's one thing to take away apart from the promise that this holds, it's that, you know, the government just could do so much more to expedite and support the process. But, you know, the dysfunction that occurs in our governmental process is just, I mean, it's just mind-boggling. Is there a gene for that?
It's not rare.
Yes.
In 4 years of high school, do they have any kind of mental health screen? And I think the kids are at far greater risk from things like anxiety and depression
absolutely
than 2 degrees of scoliosis, which they send a note home about. Absolutely. So when I asked why they don't have a mental health screen, I was told, oh, we would never do that. And I think that's reflective of the stigma that's still associated with mental illness. And frankly, I think the stigma also reduces the number of patients who participate in psychiatric clinical trials compared to things like cancer trials. So what can we do to try to fight this stigma? And two, do you think in our lifetime we can bring together the advocacy community and all of the universities in New York and try to get legislation to have at least one mental health screen for kids who are in high school?
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. It's appalling, and it's so obviously a double standard and consequence of stigma. I mean, you know, I don't know where to begin, and we don't have enough time. You can almost understand it if you think that what we think of as mental disorders, whether it's autism or anxiety or psychosis, for human history, were not understood. The field of medicine and science could not explain what it was, and there were no treatments for it until the latter part of the 20th century. So there was, you know, hundreds of years where there was nothing. So it was kind of written off. In the last 50 years, there's been game-changing improvements, but the vestigial attitudes still persist, and you're describing a lot of. Since I published a book recently, I got encouraged by my publisher to get into social media, like what do I know about tweeting and Facebook and Instagram and so forth. So I just came into our hospital today and saw they were doing tuberculosis screening. And so I took a picture and I tweeted it out saying, you know, we're doing TB screening in my hospital. Why can't we do mental illness screening? And why don't we do it in schools, which is the sweet spot for the onset of mental illness? And it's all stigma. It's all stigma. So what can we do? I think, you know, there's the getting the media engaged side, but probably the science is going to be the most persuasive. You know, when you have a gene, when you have a diagnostic test, when you have some biomarkers, these will, I think, begin to sway public opinion.
There's also a model of trying to integrate psychiatric care into medical care, so it's called collaborative care. And this is an example where if pediatricians, besides legislature and the schools and the universities, which I think is a great idea, but I also think if pediatricians, as part of their annual physical, were required to do some sort of mental health, you'd sort of build it, there's a way of sort of building it in. I remember with my pediatrician educating him about OCD onset after untreated streptococcal infections and bringing him articles to explain why I wanted to get my kid antibiotics for his strep infection. And he, great pediatrician, but knew nothing about it. Yeah.
And it's, people sometimes just don't want to open up the can of worms because they don't know what to do about it next. And I think that that's a place we need to educate our colleagues. But this is something our division, Child Psychiatry at Columbia, has been huge on. Because, you know, scoliosis is not one of the, you know, leading causes of morbidity or mortality in adolescents. Suicide is. And this is something we know a lot about screening for, but people are really hesitant to do it. And we absolutely need to push.
I wrote an article that was in USA Today a few weeks ago. It was called Reading, Writing, and Mental Illness. And it was basically saying that, you know, people are dropping their kids off for college, sending their kids off to college, and when they applied to these colleges, they thought about their curriculum and their campus and their sports teams and their faculty, but they didn't think about their mental health care services, and they probably should have. And, you know, so I think you're right on, but it's not a quick fix. Sir?
Yeah, observation, I think you've developed a fabulous team here, a really very special question I have is, with so many veterans coming home with PTSD, and this isn't just the first of the Middle East wars, but you have previously all these wars, is there any testing or anything that's been done to say that someone could have a predilection to high stress incidents, where then these people would be screened perhaps out of these danger areas?
In fact, there's a huge major study being done on Marines. I think it was, I don't remember now the numbers. I mean, I'm talking about like 30,000, I mean, huge study, which was actually looking at exactly this question. And I haven't seen all the data presented, but it was looking at probes of fear circuitry and how people handle, a startle, something called sensory motor gating, which is how much you can sort of gate out things as it comes in and goes out, to actually test Marines before they were first deployed and then see what happened. What's interesting, the data that I had seen as a partial presentation of that, which I think is really, really interesting, is they have a very low rate. So the idea of what is we're going to use this baseline data of how their nervous system reacts to these laboratory paradigms to predict who is going to go on and not go on to get PTSD with this exact idea. What's really interesting is that this group of soldiers, who are special soldiers, have a much lower rate of getting PTSD. So even though they started in a very huge sample, the rate of PTSD was much lower than predicted. So that was the interim report that I saw, and they were hoping to see more. Obviously, you can see that from the Marines' point of view, this took the military being really on board with this, because talk about stigma, right? You're a soldier, you want to go to combat. You know, how do you feel being analyzed to see whether you're fit? And none of our predictors are 100%. It's just like a genetic risk. But it's a very interesting question.
Even before, undoubtedly, there are susceptibility measures, genetic and otherwise. But even before that, you would think that you could develop a, before people go into combat, are deployed, and the same thing could be for first responders, police and fire, that you would have some preparatory process to basically inoculate them to a limited degree, and then following their exposure to sort of decompress them, debrief them, that could attempt to, even before we had these identification of people who may be at greater risk. And why we don't take it seriously is baffling. Do we have time for me to take these three written questions or no? Okay. If with your permission to go a little bit, and then afterwards we have coffee and dessert and whatever else. But David, there's a question. How many generations back in terms of a pedigree is it important to track mental illness history?
As far as you can. So the family history tells you a great deal about the possible contributions of genetics, and in fact, other contributions as well. And so typically, you try to learn as much as you possibly can reliably.
But the problem is that the level of information you might have, particularly going back in these kinds of disorders, is probably...
Realistically, you rarely go back more than three generations because you don't get accurate information beyond that. But you would like, except in very special circumstances, where it's proven extremely valuable, like Iceland and Amish and other situations. But normally you can't go back more than three generations.
And then, Jeremy, what autistic populations have the identified mutation?
So the current testing we do clinically hits about 10% in terms of finding a variant that contributes to their risk. That doesn't mean it's causal, but means that it contributes. If you do whole exome sequencing or increasingly moving to whole genome sequencing, rates are likely to hit somewhere between 15 and 20%, probably higher as we are able to interpret things better. And that's really the limit. So as David described, right now you can look at those areas where we can make an interpretation, but when you find something that's in a genomic region that's not well understood, it may be 5 years, it may be 10 years before you know for sure what that is actually doing from a biological perspective. So, but that's a significant percentage, and it always feels a little disappointing to say, you know, it's less than the majority. But 5 years ago, it was 1%, okay? And those were kids who a good physician should be able to make the diagnosis without sending the genetic test. So this is actually huge. I mean, it's revolutionary, maybe 10 years ago. I mean, it's been evolving over time, but it's a huge change.
Sandra, are there any approved targeted therapies for a psychiatric disorder currently?
Well, the example I gave for limbic encephalitis is kind of a weird example because technically the neurologist will claim it's a neurological disorder because there's a treatment.
Once we understand, this is a point of tension.
That's not meant to sound bitter in any way. But I think that's one of the rare examples where it's very clearly, unambiguously established that that is the cause, there's a treatment, the majority of people get better, period. So that's one of the few examples we have now where that approach seems to work. With the genetic risk factors, we're not there yet, but we are working very hard to get there. And my prediction would be in the next several years that's going to happen.
And for early onset Alzheimer's disease with the presenilin genes, there's no treatment that's targeted to it.
They're doing a very large trial in Colombia, the country of Colombia, with an isolated founder population who have a rare mutation in that gene, where a very large percentage of people with that mutation get a very early onset, very severe form of Alzheimer's. It's the NIH's opinion that instead of going to people with advanced forms of Alzheimer's, that they need to go to that population and find out, is there any way to slow down or even potentially prevent the onset and the course of the illness? I'm a firm believer in that approach. Our clinical trial is very much inspired by that, what we want to do in autistic subjects from the Amish community who have a risk variant that causes autism. But My opinion is that I think that's where we need to go.
And Blair, what are the causes for social anxiety disorders, and what are the recommended treatments?
So social anxiety disorder is one of the anxiety disorders. It's also called social phobia, where people are very anxious in any type of social situation. Typically, people have generalized social anxiety to all sorts of different types of social anxiety. But you've probably heard of this as performance anxiety when it's just the person who has stage fright. Stage fright is considered to be sort of the least severe part of social anxiety. It's this generalized form. And as you can imagine, these people don't raise their hand in class when they were a kid. You know, they're always in the back of the class. They're not going out for theater or drama. They have a really hard time dating. Job interviews are a nightmare for them. And there's one story of a patient in our clinic who had a heart attack, was having like chest pain and turned out to have a heart attack, but was too anxious to ask anybody for the nearest hospital and so walked across Central Park to find, you know, the hospital on his own. So true story, and then got diagnosed with a heart attack, and it was really his social anxiety. What causes it? You know, this is where we are with, other than OCD, with many of the anxiety disorders, it's not as genetic. But exactly, you know, obviously there's some data that bullying can actually lead to social anxiety, but probably only in someone who's at risk, you know, for this to begin with. There's certainly, we see in our clinic, people who are migrants from other countries, who've come from another country and come to America. We see a lot of those people, but we don't know how much of that is clinician bias. They're the ones who are showing up for treatment. So I don't think we really know what causes social anxiety, but we do know that these kids have a tendency to be very inhibited as little kids. So there's this temperament called behavioral inhibition. And it used to be thought that those kids went on to get panic disorder, but actually a large number of those kids go on to get a socially anxious diagnosis. So we think it's pretty long-standing, this fear of foreigners, if you will, strangers in their midst. Treatments. So just like for many of the anxiety disorders, there's two types of first-line treatments. One is treatment with medications, and the other one is treatment with this cognitive behavioral therapy. You do the cognitive behavioral therapy for social anxiety differently than you do for OCD, but these treatments can be very, very effective. And I have to say is that as a clinician, treating people with social anxiety, it's like a flower blooms in front of you. I mean, it's like you don't need a rating scale to know whether it works. It's like suddenly the person who's been like this in your waiting room, you know, suddenly is sitting up and looking at you in the eye. I mean, it's really, when the treatments work, it's really wonderful. And you really feel like you've done something because someone can now be in the world and be themselves. And these are people who want to be out in the world. They're just so anxious. It's different than, I mean, it's interesting when we go into our clinic, one issue is it first break psychosis or is it social anxiety, right? Because the person who's like this, is it paranoia or is it anxiety? And, you know, in our clinic, it's the anxiety. And in your clinic, I guess, it can go the other way.
Well, I want to thank you. You've been a wonderful audience for your attention, your questions. And you're looking at a dream team up here in terms of the intellectual and scientific talent, and you know, we're moving forward, and hopefully all these amazing discoveries and therapeutic applications, particularly for the aging brain, will be in time for all of us. So, thank you.